After this, I looked at the sky and saw something else that was strange and important. Seven angels were bringing the last seven terrible troubles. When these are ended, God will no longer be angry. Then I saw something that looked like a glass sea mixed with fire, and people were standing on it. They were the ones who had defeated the beast and the idol, the number that tells the name of the beast. God had given them harps. They were singing the song that his servant Moses and the Lamb had sung. They were singing, "Lord God, all-powerful, you have done great and marvelous things. You are the ruler of all nations, and you do what is right and fair. Lord, who doesn't honor and praise your name? You alone are holy. All nations will come and worship you because you have shown that you judge with fairness." After this, I noticed something else in heaven. The sacred tent used for a temple was open, and the seven angels who were bringing the terrible troubles were coming out of it. They were dressed in robes of pure white linen and wore belts made of pure gold. One of the four living creatures gave each of the seven angels a bowl made of gold. These bowls were filled with the anger of God, who lives forever and ever. The temple quickly filled with smoke from the glory and power of God. No one could enter it until the seven angels had finished pouring out the seven last troubles.
Let's talk about the preparation for that in Revelation chapter 15. If you have your notes with you, I'm sure you have them. Look at the first verse with me. The first verse says, "Then I saw another sign in heaven." Remember where we're coming from. We're coming from Revelation 14. As you remember last week, we talked about the grapes of wrath, right? The picture of, I believe, God is beginning to help us continue to understand that that is a picture of the cross. You know, we're going to see it more again tonight. These seven bowls, the seven plagues, if you will, it's a picture of the cross. So as you go on and you read your first verse there, as a matter of fact, Brother Mark, why don't you read, you got your mic there, why don't you read verse 1 for us again, please.
"Then I saw another sign in heaven, great and marvelous, seven angels having the seven last plagues, for in them the wrath of God is complete."
Okay, folks, okay. You know, just as a precursor, do you know when Jesus Christ first came to the earth, you know, his mission was to save the souls of men. And if you also remember, his displeasure really was against the religious system. It wasn't against the people. You know, it wasn't against the adulterers or the murderers or the thieves or the tax collectors. It was against the religious system. So I don't know why in Revelation we kind of like turn the tables and we think now God's going to get the adulterers and the murderers. No, he's still against the religious system. In the book of Revelation, he's saving the people, every last one of them. But he's going to destroy the religious system. That's what he did in the beginning, and that's what he's going to do at the end. The roles didn't change. Praise God, right? Yeah, that's beautiful. You know, so even as we read verse 1, there's two words in particular that I must define with you just to clarify. The two words I want to define is the first word is plagues, and the second word is wrath. In this passage, and as we're about to, pour forth the seven bowls, or it says here in your scripture there, it says, having the seven last plagues, I want you to see along with me the definition. It's in your commentary. Look there under 15:1, and it has the Greek word for the word plague there. Let's see. You can read along, but I'm going to ask Brother Mark, would you read the definition? It starts off with a stroke. What is the definition of that word plague? Do you see it there, Brother Mark? Yeah, come on down, page 1. It says the 7 last plagues, okay. All right? And then it says New Testament, NT 4127, okay? A stroke. Go ahead.
A stroke by a palpitation, a wound.
Figuratively.
Figuratively, a calamity, plague, stripe, wound.
Look at the definition for the word plague. It is a wound. A plague is a wound. It is a stripe. These are the 7 wounds of Christ upon the cross. These plagues, you can use, you know, sometimes we need to use different words, at least in our own mind, to get clearer understanding. What are these 7 plagues? They are the 7 wounds of Christ. The 7 wounds of Christ. Amen? Can I get an amen from anybody out there? And we talked about the 7 wounds. Next week, we're going to break them down one by one to see how these 7 wounds of Christ are going to complete the wrath of God. And we're going to define that in a moment, too. Okay, once again, the 7 wounds of Christ upon the cross. First, it was the head, right? That's going to be the first bowl poured forth. We're going to talk about the wounds that Christ received on his head and what that does to redeem mankind. The second wound, we're going to talk about the stripes on the back of Christ. That was the second wound of Christ. We're going to talk we're going to define that as the second bowl poured forth upon humanity. The third bowl, or the third plague, if you will, or the third wound, will be his right hand. We'll specifically talk about his right hand and what his right hand does for us, and then his left hand, and then his right foot, and then his left foot, and then the piercing in his side. The 7 wounds of Christ upon the cross, because the wrath of God, or the grapes of wrath, is seen at the cross. It's the cross, everybody. And the 7 last plagues, you can see the definition there with your own eyes. You can see the definition is a wound. And we're going to see how these wounds are the 7 last wounds, if you will. Because Christ said upon the cross, it is finished. With those wounds, God destroyed every enemy. We constantly have to define the enemies. Who are the enemies? What are the enemies? Sin and death are the enemies. There's 2. Sin and death. Not people. He came to save people. He's not destroying them. We want to destroy people. God doesn't. God wants to destroy you with your thinking that you want to destroy people. Every one of us who want people to go to hell and be hurt, and he's going to destroy that thinking, that sin, that death. That's what he's destroying. So with that, let's see. The 7 last plagues. That and the redemption that we get from the cross of Christ. Look at the next word that we want to define. The next word I want to define is the word wrath. Wrath. And by definition, read there with me, this is the Greek word for wrath. It means passion, everybody. This is the absolute passion of God. As a matter of fact, the week of Christ before the cross is called the Passion Week. Sure. And continue to look at the definition. It's as if breathing hard. And goes on to say to breathe hard, to blow smoke, and we see smoke even in this passage. But it's talking about the absolute passion of God, a release, a full release, a full vent of his passion that will absolutely destroy the enemies of your soul, amen. The enemies of humanity. It's the passion of God, so much so. That he sent his son in the form of flesh. He was willing to die. It's how passionate he was about you and about destroying your enemies and healing your hurts and healing your plagues or your wounds. Amen, everybody. Yeah, let us continue to see this even in regard to the plagues. The plagues are the wounds of Christ. The wrath is his passion that is poured out. And it was poured out, everybody, not in your future. Was poured out upon the cross. The greatest event to ever happen in this world was Christ. You think there's ever going to be a greater event than Christ dying upon the cross? Is there a greater event in the future? There's no greater event. That's the climax of it all. In the fullness of time, God sent forth his son. Right? Yeah, man. And what's going on in the book of Revelation is he's not telling us about future events. He's giving us a revelation of what Christ did. a revelation of what happened upon that cross, because we don't know. And sometimes, you know, we see these images of Christ dying upon the cross, and us in our humanity, we get very emotional, but it's not an emotional event. It's a spiritual happening. So we get emotional and we cry. We say, oh, poor Jesus. That's nonsense. There's something so much greater than that. The impact of what happened, they're all symbolisms. Jesus dying upon a cross, the symbol of that, what that meant to us, we don't know. Poor Jesus, he was the conqueror upon the cross. He was the king upon that cross. And he destroyed sin, death, hell, the grave upon that cross. Poor Jesus. I say, poor Satan, he just destroyed that day. Oh, that poor devil. That poor devil, he thinks he's so smart. Okay, Revelation 1. Let's turn our pages. Okay. Brother Mark, would you read for us Revelation 15:2?
And I saw, as it were, a sea of glass mingled with fire, and them that had gotten the victory over the beast, and over his image, and over his mark, and over the number of his name, stand on the sea of glass, having the harp of God.
Okay. Now, this is what we've been talking about as of late. We've been talking about the beast. And we've defined the beast, I think, very clearly. The beast is man without God. And God's ultimate plan of salvation, his plan is to save the souls of men. So destroying the beast, in other words, is he saving your soul from your destruction? Who is your worst enemy? Your worst enemy is not outside of you. You look in the mirror, that's your worst enemy. You are your own worst enemy. Your enemies are not outside of you, they're inside of you. You might create some on the outside of you, but they're inside of you. That's all your enemies are inside. It's called the beast. And this is what God is destroying here. You know, another picture of that, and I'd like to mention it before we even get to it. You know, later on in the book, we talk about the harlot who rides upon the beast. And we've talked about that a little bit. But I want us to see transformation. This is always a picture of the soul of man. Even the harlot, there's two women in the book of Revelation. There's the harlot and the bride. You know, you could say God destroys the harlot or he saves the harlot. Either one. Who's the harlot? I'm sorry. Instead of saying you, I'll say we are. We are the harlot. It's our souls that are being saved. He turns the harlot into his bride. Beautiful, huh? Yeah, yeah. And he also saves the soul. There's this transformation here. The beast, it's like the movie Beauty and the Beast. You are the beast, but you become the beauty. It's a transformation. What's going on through the book, it's transformation. He's changing you. He's saving you. The world, one at a time. We're starting with you. Start with you first. Me first. That's the book, everybody. That's the book. It's not about outside forces. It's about God doing something beautiful in your heart, in your soul. Saving your souls. Full-time job. But he's doing good so far, everybody. Let's break this down a little bit. It says in your commentary, it says the sea of glass. The sea of glass. Okay. This answers to the molten sea. Those of you who know what the molten sea is, it's that brazen laver that the priests had to wash themselves in before they could enter the tabernacle. Any Bible students out there? You had the altar of fire, then you had the brazen laver. You washed yourself in the sea of glass, if you will. And it talks about a purifying. God takes the water and he purifies you with the washing of the water of the word. It typifies also the baptism with water. And the spirit of all made kings and priests unto God. You see, God is using this water, if you will, this water, he's using it to wash us and cleanse us and save us. It's the sea. It's the tumultuous sea at times, you know. Sometimes it's the tumultuous things that God uses in our lives to save us and change us and purify us. Anybody out there? This is the water. It's the picture of God purifying us, but the fire also, because it says that they walked on a sea of glass and it was mingled with what? Fire. And then, you know, as says in your commentary, this answers to the baptism of fire or fiery trials, as well as the Holy Spirit, which Christ's people undergo to purify them. Once again, the fire is for purification. Actually, you know, the difference between the two is the water will wash you and cleanse you. Anybody been washed and cleansed by the waters of baptism? Yeah. So if you sin 1,000 times a day, or maybe 2,000, the waters will, 3,000, can I hear 4,000? The waters will wash you. They will wash you every time. Amen. Praise God for the waters that wash you. Until you get a better baptism than the baptism of water, because John says there's a better baptism. If you're getting washed and washed and washed, somebody's got to baptize you with fire. Because the fire baptism, which is greater than the baptism of John, it changes you. Because fire changes, right? Has the ability to change. Fire changes you into the new man. And then you're not sinning so much. You don't need the water so much. You've been changed. But as the fire changes you, you need the water in the interim. You understand? So this is the water and the fire. You know, and I continually like to see the images in the Bible. Where else do you see lakes of water and fire together? How about the lake of fire? What is the lake of fire? It's the same thing. It's the sea of glass mingled with fire. What's the purpose of the lake of fire? Very simple. You know, the Bible, and we say this 1,000 times, but maybe you haven't heard it yet. There's only 5 things that goes into the lake of fire or the water baptism. Who goes into the lake of fire? Who goes into the lake of fire? Were you ever water baptized? Then you went into the lake of fire. Were you ever baptized with fire? Sure, every one of you. Then you go into the lake of fire. Who gets thrown into the lake of fire? You. Is that a bad thing? No, it's a good thing. Why? What does the lake of fire do? Destroys 5 things. Destroys the devil, the false prophet. What else does it destroy? Hell, the grave. I kind of forget the 5. We'll get to it again. But there's 5 things. Who's going to the lake of fire? You. To destroy your hell and your devil and this and that and the other thing. It's this. It's the water that washes you and the fire that purges you. I know we've created all kinds of doctrine and theology with it, but that's okay. God knew we would. That's why he came to destroy the religious system. Huh? Amen. You see, and you know, for those of you who haven't heard before, the question, the ultimate question, Christian question, is not are you going to heaven and hell. We say it all the time here. Hell is not a place of final destination. If anyone's read the book, hell is destroyed by the lake of fire. So no one can go to hell because hell is destroyed. At the end of Revelation, hell doesn't exist anymore. It doesn't exist anymore at the end of Revelation. So no one's going to hell and staying there. I mean, you're in hell now and you visit every so often. I don't know why, but every so often you visit hell. Maybe to hang out with us, the rest of us, because we go there once in a while. But hell's not a place of final destination, like there's going to be this great judgment and then God's going to send some to heaven and some to hell. Where'd you get that theology from? Well, from you, preacher. Okay, but I changed. Because at the end of the book, hell is thrown into the lake of fire. The lake of fire destroys hell. What's the lake of fire? It's right here. It's the baptism of water, and it's the baptism of fire. God will destroy your hell. He will destroy your devil. He will destroy your beast and your false prophet. He will destroy it. Didn't he come to the earth for that? Didn't Jesus go to hell so you don't have to? Right? Why did he go to hell? He was looking for you. He found you. Okay, moving right on. It says in regard to this sea of fire, glass, sea of water mingled with fire. It says, to them that had gotten victory over, and them that had gotten victory over what? Over the beast. Praise God. You and I are going to get victory over our beast. Amen. It's the word of the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Anybody else? Thank you, Jesus. It's a nice thing. And his nature and so on. You know, what does it say there? It says, those coming off from conflict with the beast. Yeah. Yeah, because you notice, you know, that beast came out of the sea, right? Yeah, in the tumultuous sea. But there comes a time where the sea is no longer tumultuous and the beast is destroyed. And you and I walk upon that. You know, it's victory over. It's walking on top of these things where we actually have victory over the beast nature. How do you have victory over the beast? Just keep adding God. Just keep adding God. Keep on talking to him. As often as you can remember, tell him that you love him. You know, enjoy your relationship with him. Keep adding God. You keep adding God. Yeah. I must say, you know, even as we continue, I pray and I know that you were delivered as much as I was delivered. I think God gave us that message on Sunday about the wheat and the tares. I know God set me free. I know God set me free, and I pray he set you free too. Where God says the biggest thing and the truest thing in your life is the wheat. It's the God in you. You know, the tares don't disqualify us from the kingdom, and they shouldn't preoccupy us. God's not concerned with the tares in our lives. The tares and should never keep us from the kingdom. It's not the sin that disqualifies us from God. It's God that disqualifies the sin. The truest part of us is the fact that we do love God. I just, you know, praise God for what he gave me, and I believe he gave you. You know, so here it says that at one point we are standing on the sea of glass, and standing does imply rest. You know, it's this quietness, this still sea. It's God causing your troubles and your struggles to calm down a little bit. Uh-huh. Isn't that nice? You know, it says the sea typifies the troubled state out of which the beast arose and is to be no more in the blessed world. So the victorious saints stand on it. And then it goes on, it says, which is also nice, it says, firm footing amidst apparent instability is represented there. Praise God, huh? Like Jesus walking on the water, right? There's symbolisms there. The happiness is heightened by retrospect of danger through which they have passed. Have you been through the waters? Have you been through the fire? God said, you're going to go through the waters, but what, everybody? You will not drown. You will go through the fires, but what, everybody? You will not be burned. But you will go through the water, and you will go through the fire. It's your redemption. Uh-huh. And then even with the harps of God, it talks about, it surpasses the timbrels of Miriam and the Israelites. This victory that God gives us, I pray that this week has been a week of singing or rejoicing or just joy, if you will, in regard to the things he's given us. Amen. All right, pop. That's a good amen. So let's look at some of the other verses, guys. Let's look at Revelation 15:3. This one's interesting. Brother Mark, would you read that for us?
And they sing the song of Moses, the servant of God, and the song of the Lamb, saying, great and marvelous are thy works, Lord God Almighty. Just and true are thy ways, thy King of saints.
Okay. You know, so many times in the book of Revelation, we're referred back to the song of Moses, and we know. And I guess Moses was one of the most significant characters in the Old Testament and what he did with the Israelites. You know, God set his people free. God took the Israelites from Egyptian bondage, right? He brought them out through the wilderness, through the Red Sea, the parting of the Red Sea. And even in the Red Sea, the Egyptian army was destroyed. And then from that place, of course, they went to Mount Sinai. And from that place, they went into the Promised Land. As great as that was in history, it was only a symbolic, it was symbolic of something spiritual, of the true Exodus. Because the true Exodus was not the Moses Exodus. That was a natural one. But the true Exodus is a spiritual Exodus. And it typified that of Christ's Exodus. And that's what we see in Luke. If you look there in your notes at Luke chapter 9, and this talks about the transfiguration, when Jesus went upon the mountain and he was transfigured, this is the true Exodus. Look at that with me. It's in your notes. It says in verse 29, it says, as he was praying, this is Christ, the appearance of his face was changed. His clothes became as bright as a flash of lightning. And two men, Moses and Elijah, appeared in glorious splendor talking with Jesus. And they spoke about his departure. That word is Exodus. That word is translated in the Greek, Exodus. They talk about the true Exodus, which Moses was only a type of. the true Exodus, which he was about to bring to fulfillment at Jerusalem, speaking of the cross. Once again, there's no great, the greatest event in history was not Moses and the Red Sea. The greatest event in history was Christ and the cross. And everything else was a type of that. So here on the Mount of Transfiguration, what a beautiful thing here. All of these things that we see that's so grand with Moses talks about the true Exodus. When you and I leave a worldly system, we leave our natural life without God, and we enter into the promised land, a life with God. You know, the true Exodus is us leaving sin and death. The true Exodus is us leaving our carnal and natural thinking, entering into a spiritual place. That's the true Exodus. When Jesus died upon the cross, he died as the last Adam. It was a death to and a coming out of our old ways, our old thinking, our old life, a life centered upon self and self-gratification and ego and pride and so on and so forth. That is the true Exodus. Moses was a type of it. And you have Moses on the mountain appearing with Jesus, Moses and Elijah. And why Moses and Elijah? You know why Moses. Moses is the law and Elijah is the prophets. Jesus was the fulfillment of both the law and the prophets. Amen. Religion says that you still have a law to fulfill and a prophecy to fulfill. Jesus says, I've done it all.
Thank you, Jesus.
Even the book of Revelation, that's not a future. Jesus already fulfilled the book of Revelation. We think Revelation is the future prophecy.
All prophecy is
fulfilled in Christ.
Amen.
Revelation is a story about Christ. Fulfilling all of the law and the prophets. So when they saw the law, they saw Moses and Elijah. They said, let us build a tabernacle for Moses and Elijah. And then pretty soon after that, you didn't see them anymore. So you're not building a tabernacle for Moses and Elijah. We're not following the law, and we're not looking for prophecies to be fulfilled. It's all in Christ.
Amen.
What you and I need is an exodus,
Amen.
A departure from sin, death, the grave, works, self. That's what we see in Revelation here. The true exodus, which we saw at the cross. And then even involved with the true exodus, what Jesus experienced is what you and I are experiencing in life. See, God wants to bring a change in your life. It says that his appearance of his face changed. God wants to change us entirely, and he is changing us. Man, he's changing our identity. He's changing the way we think. He's changing the way we live and the reason why we live. He's changing it all. And the next few verses talk about it, and it's so powerful, I think, you know, that this true exodus is talking about a transformation of not only mind and body, truly of mind and body and soul and spirit. A complete transformation is what the true exodus is a picture of, where he changes you entirely, because he says also that his clothes became bright as flashes of lightning, and lightning is always a symbolic of the coming of the Lord. It's the appearing of Jesus, you know. Doesn't Scripture say he'll come like the lightning flashes from the east to the west? Lightning is a picture of the coming of the Lord. Where? 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 In your flesh. It talks about his garments. Garments is a picture of your flesh. Where is Jesus coming back? In the sky? I don't know. But this doesn't talk about that. He's talking about Jesus coming back in you. In your flesh. He's going to change your garments. What? I'm going to wear a white shirt tomorrow instead of a blue, whatever color shirt this is. What do you think he's talking about when he's changing your garments? You become the body of Christ. You are the body of Christ. You can say it any way you want. You're his hands. You're his feet. You are the coming of Christ. The Bible doesn't even talk about the second coming. One time it refers to it. He shall come a second time. It doesn't even talk about the second coming. He's the ever coming one. He's continually coming in your life and my life, continually, perpetually. He's coming in the clouds. You are the clouds, everybody. There's nothing more greater than Christ appearing in your life. Him appearing in a cloud, there's no majesty in Christ appearing up there. There's no majesty in that. The only majesty is him appearing in your life. Him coming in your flesh. I'll tell you what the real miracle of God is. Not him coming in a cloud. It's you changing your mind. And you loving and forgiving and being kind and patient and gentle, that is a miracle that I have not seen yet. Have you seen that one? I haven't seen it yet. I've seen bits and pieces of it. What, you guys don't, what's up? You're not happy with me tonight? What's going on? If you can't see it in yourself, I know you can see it in your neighbor. I know you can. The greatest miracle of all is not God doing something in the sky. It's Him doing something in you. It's making you loving and forgiving and absolutely selfless. Selfless. Remember, to live in a carnal realm is to live in a selfish realm. What do I get? And it's even this stinking religious thinking that we're better than anybody else. Oh, I'm chosen of God. Oh, and everybody else isn't. Just you. I'm the elect and everybody else is no good. I'm going to get the blessing and I'm going to take your prosperity from you. Where do you get these words from? And that's what you say, well, you preacher. Anything that preaches elitism and one group better than another group, it's not the gospel, it's not God. For in Christ Jesus, there's neither male nor female, Greek nor Jew, right? So on and so forth. But God has to destroy somebody. He is the beast. Somebody's got to go to hell. They are. Everybody? The beast. Somebody's got to go to hell. Yeah, not you. You don't want to go, do you? Let's send the beast to hell. Let's send the devil. Who is the devil? I tell you what, man, I've seen the devil look like human beings many times. You guys are not having fun with me tonight. I don't know what's going on tonight. I got no idea. That's right. So, as we go on, moving right along now, in verse 4 it says, who shall not fear the Lord and glorify thy name? For thou art holy. For all nations shall come and worship before thee, for thy judgments are made manifest. This is what's going on right now. 5 says, after that I looked, and behold, the temple of the tabernacle of the testimony in heaven was opened. When you read this, what do you think about? You think about where heaven is and some kind of temple in heaven, like some kind of an open door of blessing falling down from heaven somewhere. Because usually when we think of heaven, we think of heaven. Even when God said in Hebrews that he cleansed the true heavens with his blood, you think the true heavens are out there? No, you're the true heavens. He didn't shed his blood for that. He shed his blood for you. You needed the blood of Jesus, not this heaven that's out there somewhere. That doesn't need blood. You needed it. I needed it. It cleanses me from my sin. So in Hebrews, when he took the blood and went through the true tabernacle, the true heavens, he went through my life and my heart and my soul. He cleansed me and purified me. It's me. So here in this passage here, because Paul says, know ye not that you are the temple of the Holy Spirit? Anybody ever read that one? Paul said, you're the temple. Did anybody tell you that you're the temple of the Holy Spirit? Has anyone told you? And even that word there, that Greek word, it's naos. That word temple, it's naos. It means the inner sanctuary. And it's the same word here. The same Greek word that Paul used is the same Greek word that's used here. It's the word naos. It's the inner sanctuary. Do you not know that you are the temple? So in Revelation 15:5, it's talking about you. And after this, I looked, and behold, the temple of the tabernacle of the testimony in heaven was opened. You were opened up. What opened you up? The blood of Jesus Christ that was poured forth on the cross of Calvary. What happened when Jesus was upon the cross of Calvary? It says the veil was rent. Amen. What veil? Your flesh. Your carnal thinking. Whatever keeps you and separates you from God. Flesh and blood keeps you from God. What, this? No, not this. This. The way you think. Natural thinking keeps you from God. So far, is that okay, everybody? I want us to see what the blood of Jesus did, these grapes of wrath, these seven plagues, these seven wounds of Christ. What does it do? Well, we have the picture of it with Christ. Christ, once again, that was a picture when Christ died upon the cross and the veil was rent. It was a picture of God splitting the veil in you and causing your temple now to be made open. Why? So God can get in? I don't think so. I think God's already in there. I think so God can get out. In the tabernacle, man, my speech is way off. I don't know what's going on. In the tabernacle, was that pumpernickel? I must be hungry. In the tabernacle, whichever one it may be, Moses's, David's, Solomon's, what was in the most holy place? God was there. Was it empty? Thanks. Nobody knew that one. No, not empty. God was there. Where's the Ark of the Covenant? The Ark of the Covenant was there. It was the symbol of the presence of God. What was always in the temple? God. In every temple that was ever built, Moses's, Solomon's, Herod's, David's, always had the Ark of the Covenant, the presence of God. Inside of humanity is the presence of God. You can't see it because there's a veil. You think there's nothing there. There's nothing there. All I see is the flesh. Well, let's rip it then. Let's tear it. Let's bust through it. Amen. He did. He went to the cross. He died upon. His blood gave access into the true heavens. The veil was rent. So what? So he can get in? Maybe. But really so he can get out. Amen. So the God inside of you can get out. And that's what we're going to read here in the next few verses. Where do these seven angels come with the seven plagues? They come from inside the temple, from inside of you. These angels, these messengers, these words of redemption are inside of you. Somebody's got to let them out. Amen. Good, Pop, thanks. Yes. This is what's going on here. Jesus is letting them out. So these seven angels are coming out of you. The message is going to come out of you. Where, man? Where? It's going to come out of your spirit. You're going to have a word of life to this world. Why? Because you read it in a book? You can't read it in a book. No man can teach you this. You know that, right? It's inside of you. Amen. It's inside of you. It's just that it was covered by the veil. That's why the veil is rent. And ta-da, the veil is open. The temple is open. I now see. And what's going to happen once it's open? Now these seven angels with the seven plagues are now going to come out of the temple and release them upon the earth. What? The message of God, man. Amen. The message of the cross. That sounds like my God. And I'm very happy to be a part of this. This is what I want. This is what I want to preach. This is what I want to give the world. Not damnation. Let the devil give the world damnation. Let's give them salvation. Oh, that's right. The gospel is salvation. How do we get damnation out of it? It's salvation. Ah, that's right. So, moving along. Interesting. Verse 6 says, the seven angels came out of the temple, the naos. Where are they coming out of, guys? You. That's kind of crazy, isn't it? That's freaky almost. They're coming out of you. And they have what? They have a message, if you will. The seven plagues, and they're clothed in pure white linen. This has nothing to do with man, and this is pure, man. This is all God here. Having their breastplates girded with golden girdles. I'm going to tell you, this message that needs to be preached, it's absolutely divine. We have not even heard the full extent of this gospel, this message of God. It is pure, it is holy, it is divine. It goes against all kinds of natural thinking and religion that's built and designed or created by man. We haven't even heard it yet. We hear it new and new. Don't you hear it new and new? Because the message of God and the gospel, it is progressive. It does increase and get better. You don't know it all. You know about this much. No, this much. What you don't know about God is so much greater than what you do know about God. We got nothing figured out. We don't know how beautiful our God is, how powerful he is, how much God was able to save the world, as if God sent forth his son and died upon a cross, but it didn't work. Really? Your God failed? He didn't save the world? I thought he saved the world. No, he failed. It's impossible. Because salvation is not up to you, it's up to him. He says, I save you. Amen. Not up to you. God said, I'm going to save you today. Great, because I can't save myself. So this comes out of the temple. And then this is what I want us to see here. It's going to come out of your temple. Of course, you are the first recipient of this message. But God does want he, my goodness, man, the seven plagues that have to be released upon the earth is going to come out of you. You are going to preach this message of salvation to the world, man. This message that you're hearing tonight and you've been hearing from the Spirit of God that dwells inside of you. It goes on in verse 7. It says, and one of the four beasts gave unto the seven angels seven golden vials. They're golden. They're divine, man. Full of the passion of God who liveth forever and ever. And actually, in the Greek, once again, it's not forever and ever. Who liveth from age to age. Because forever is forever. I mean, you can't say forever and ever. It's redundant. He lives from age to age. And what age to age means this. Salvation is progressive. Can I get a witness from anybody? Yeah, I'm more saved today than I was a year ago. So he saves your soul. He gives you more peace and more joy and more help as your life progresses. Because the message is also progressive. This message, these seven plagues that come forth from you, it's the message of God. It must progress. It must become greater and greater and greater. Amen. You don't know the words. I don't even know what I'm about to preach sometimes. God has said, I don't know what to preach because it hasn't been heard yet. It hasn't been said yet. It hasn't been taught yet. It hasn't been written yet. I don't even know. Amen. Only God can reveal it. God, show us something that we don't know yet. Yes. The message is progressive. We have to hear something we've never heard before. And sometimes we hear something we've never heard before, and the natural man says, right? Because it means death of a natural man. That's why he says, because you can't work for it, you can't earn it, and you get no glory for it. It's all him. God has to show you something and tell you something that you've never heard before. And that's why it's his passion that's revealed from age to age. And the progressive message is what brings the salvation to this world. And I believe this world will experience more salvation and greater salvation, and greater people will receive greater salvation. Amen. Because the message is progressive. And it must come forth from the inner man, from the naos. Well, we got a message of the cross. What's the message of the cross? God died to save mankind. He destroyed the sin, death, the enemy. It's destroyed already. Preach the gospel. Just go tell them. Your job is to tell them what Jesus did. Go tell the world what Jesus did. You know what religion says? Go tell the world what they have to do to get Jesus. That's not the gospel. Who twisted that? Once again, religion, the preachers. The message of the gospel is to tell everybody what Jesus did. Go tell them. Tell them Jesus died, they're saved, their sin is forgiven. Not their sins will be forgiven. Their sins are forgiven. And if their sins are forgiven, what's left for them? Glory. Amen. It's free. We want to put a price tag on it. It's free. Can't afford it anyway. Oh, but we like to extract, don't we? We do like to extract because we're the tax collectors, just by the way. Okay, and then it goes on and it says, let's end. All right. Verse 8, it says, and the temple was filled with smoke, that's you, filled with the glory of God, and from his power. Look, it says, and no man was able to enter the temple till these seven plagues were fulfilled. Listen, this message that God has to preach, no man can touch this. This is not birthed in the heart of man or the mind of man. This is absolutely supernatural. No eye has ever seen it. No ear has ever heard it. The power of this gospel, the freedom of this gospel, the love of God. Huh. No man can touch this. It's pure and powerful. And it's against all natural thinking and reasoning. Whew. This is truly, the blood that needs to be poured out on all humanity. It needs to be a release in our lives, and we need to pour this blood out, this life out, this message out upon all humanity. Right. Telling about the wonderful work of Jesus Christ. Amen. God bless you all. Why don't you stand, and Pastor Dad, if you'll close us. Yeah, all right.
Did you hear everything? Just before coming to service, I was home, obviously, and I turned on the television and I caught a Christian program. And you know what I saw? Monsters. Here we go. The pastor was ministering on or speaking on Revelation, and I saw these monsters again. You know, some 40 years ago, God revealed to me much of what this whole tribulation. Because as man teaches it, you're going to have to run to hide. But if the Spirit teaches, you'll run to God.
Amen.
And that's what Pastor Mike is opening up. I know you don't get this anyplace because I've seen too many other places that are teaching. And every time I hear them teaching on Revelation, it's like, oh, come on. Give me a break. Get in the Spirit. Get out. You said it's Sunday. The natural thinking. You said it's Sunday. You said it again. The natural man cannot perceive the things of Spirit. So get out of your natural mind and get into the Spirit of Christ.
Amen.
This is what Pastor Mike is teaching. Spirit. There's so much natural gobbledygook that can be fed down your throat and you'll choke on it. Or do you want to feed on the power and the fullness and the life of the Spirit? I was writing. I wish I could speak on it all, but Pastor Mike has. And I'm going to say, you're only going to get it here. From all I've seen, I've been around a few years, beloved. Yeah. It's all over the world, but right now we're here. Pastor Mike, yes. But I wish they'd get it right. I wish they'd get it right. I hope you've heard something. I hope you've seen something. The fire. The fire is good. The fire, the baptism of the fire will burn away the dross and work the gold in you that will shine brightly. So, Father, we just give you praise, my God. We give you praise for the power, Father, of the Spirit and the truth of your word. May our eyes see, Father, these eyes of flesh, may they see, my God, the Spirit, the truth, the power, the light of your word, that will walk in the fullness of it. Change, my God. Change, ever increasing, day and day, Father. More and more of what you poured out to us, for us. We thank you for it in Jesus' name. All of God's people said,
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah.